Hi guys, and welcome to another episode of What's On Your Mind. It's my pleasure this week to have Raj Malhotra and Anthony Iser joining me on the show. Guys, thanks for joining me once again. We'll get straight into it today because I know you guys have quite a few interesting things you want to discuss on this episode. So Raj, why don't you kick things off and let us know what you've been looking at over the last few weeks?
Yeah, hi Chris, hi Anthony, good to be here with everybody. In the last couple of weeks, as you've know, if you've watched most of the U.S. markets, yeah, it's been a very simple trade. When rates go up, growth goes down and cyclicals rally. When rates go down, growth rallies, cyclicals tend not to rally. And it's kind of brought markets to near all-time highs, but it has this feeling where nobody really feels good about the market. Because I think investors are underinvested. I think everyone's looking for shorts that they can't find. And so no one really knows what to do. And so one common thing, me and Anthony were actually chatting right before online, where there is a lot of our students have trouble finding shorts in this market. So I wanted to highlight one of the shorts that I've had in my portfolio actually for a while now, but some of the numbers really came into light in the last week. The name is Clorox. It has about a market cap. The market cap's around $25 billion here. They just reported their earnings, and it's had a very good upward trajectory going into this year, obviously due to COVID. If you look at the EPS number in 2019, it was $6.42. In 2020, $7.46. In 2021, it's expected to be $8.35, and it's expected to slightly go lower in 2022 at $8.10. So if you look at that as a whole, the numbers don't look so bad. But if you dig into the numbers, that's where you can really see the how this name is going to struggle and is struggling going forward. So if you look at this quarter specifically, they reported $2.11 of a diluted EPS. But a big part of that was the impairment charge that they took. So as a result of the carrying values of goodwill and some other assets. So when you take that out, the diluted EPS is actually just $1.62, which is actually a 14% decrease over the year ago quarter. Now, and also what happened with these sales, they missed their estimates by $90 million, which was notable given that the EPS for the year was between 745 to 765. So now with those numbers, those numbers are much lower than estimates for 2021. And they were actually below the lowest estimate on the street going forward. But another thing to really look at when you really break down is that we all know 2021 was going to, should have been a peak for Clorox due to COVID, given that their products are all mostly cleaning supplies. Another one that, another big product no one really talks about is they have a lot of the coal for grills. So you would assume that those two products would have a decrease year over year, given that as people were only at home, there'll probably be less home barbecues, which was basically the only thing, the only source of people's entertainment for this year. But really, the other thing is when you really look into the number of for this quarter, what they did was they took a huge they took a big miss on gross margins. Their third quarter margin decreased from 43.5% from 46.7 last quarter, which is 320 basis points, which is a really big decrease. I mean, it's not a surprise given that commodity prices were much higher, and they were unable to pass that along to the consumer. But also, what the other thing is too, now what that may not seem like a big a drop in gross margins, but it really affects their operating margins by a big percent, by a big number. So looking forward in this company, there's just no way that you can buy Clorox long term at 22 times EV or 4.5 times sales. I mean, the good news is for people that have been long stock, I mean, I've been shorted since above 200, you know, now in this 180 range, it's repaired its valuation a little bit. You know, they obviously had some really good quarters, which but those are all in the rearview mirror now. You keep in mind always, you know, what's going to go in the past doesn't mean that's what's going to happen in the future. And while I don't think people are going to stop cleaning or be obsessed with cleanliness, I don't think the rush to desanitize every inch of their house and every inch of their out backyard with Clorox is going to continue. As you know, as we know, people become a little bit more more information about COVID, which is not that that's not surfaces is not how it's transmitted. So, and when you look into, you know, fiscal 2022, I mean, I see them going back to making $6 or $6.50 a share in earnings, and, you know, which is closer to 15 to 18 times earnings. But again, I just don't see that how their gross margins are going to get any better. In fact, I think they're going to continue to get worse. And like the most I would probably pay, and remember, again, this company is consumer staples product. It's not really anything different than it is. If it's Clorox or the generic cleaner next to it on the shelf, there's really no difference to people. There's not, it just clean is clean. And as you know, there's generic versions of the same product, and there's just no reason to pay this multiple for a company like this. So what I'm assuming is that this stock should be at least 20% lower as sales stabilize. But I actually don't think that could. I think it could actually be much worse than that. So I mean, the good news is again, some of the valuations come out. But you know, it should. So now I went from very bearish to just bearish. But the stock was at $150 pre-pandemic with lower input costs and sales. I think that let's assume that they get back to the same sales level, if not more. So I really don't see and you'll start to see analyst downgrades. In fact, I saw there was one this week. I think it was Wells Fargo that double downgraded it. But I could easily see the stock going to 140 from here in short order as the market realizes more and more of these things. And as the, you know, it's one of the winners of the pandemic start to come back to earth. Now, the structure I had on was the October 185, 140 put spread. I know that's a little further out, but I paid a little under $10. And with that being potential worth $45, I like the duration of that because it gave my thesis time to be right. And it had over a 3-to-1 payoff. But with a stock lower here, I'm looking to add some exposure. And the trade I like here was buying the July 180 puts for $5.75 two times, and selling one of the July 172.5 puts for 60 cents, or maybe doing a 3-to-2 ratio depending on how much money you have in your portfolio. But I really think that those two structures really give you a good risk reward for a name that I really don't think that's going to be dead money for a long time, and probably will just continue to go lower as the market realizes commodity prices are not going to go lower, and their products are just not, no one's going to pay a premium for them. And as demand for cleaning supplies and coal and such start to go down as we get to the second half of the year.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a good idea. And it's an interesting point you made about how these cleaning products, you know, they don't actually have a huge effect on COVID anyway, because they're all basically antibacterial, and obviously COVID's a virus. It is interesting, an interesting observation that, you know, people have started to use loads of cleaning products, even though it's kind of redundant for COVID anyway. Anthony, let's go to you. What have you been looking at?
Thanks, Chris. And hi, Chris. Hi, Raj. Hi, everyone. Good to see you both again. Likewise, on the short front, positioned, perhaps a little bit to the long side, and shorts are, you know, not easy. They're not natural for me. I think natural short pickers tend to be glass half empty. I think people like Raj, myself, and you, Chris, are probably more glass half full. I suspect Raj is probably more glasses full, and we've got, you know, three more bottles over there when we run out. So, you know, you've got to have a fairly
almost full here.
Yeah, there you go. You're going to have, you know, you're going to have a naturally negative mindset to be natural with shorts. So my error probably is, you know, occasionally get a little bit long. So looking for shorts and looking for, in this case, something that's going to be positioned if we see some sort of hiccups on reopening. So we've had lots of names, retail names in particular, have done very well. And this name, Norwegian Cruise Lines, has only just off its 52-week high. It's trading at $30, got to $34 a couple of months ago, up from a low of $9. And as the name suggests, they operate cruise ships, which, you know, during a pandemic have not been a place that you want to be. And I just feel like it's sort of probably run a little bit hard into a reopening that hasn't happened. And the more I look at it, the more I question sort of when it's going to happen for these guys. And I feel like they're perhaps a little bit ambitious and the market's a little bit ambitious about when that's going to happen. So this is an $11 billion company. It's got a $12 billion of debt, most of which they took on in the last 18 months or so to shore up their balance sheet while losing money hand over fist. Operationally, they've got three cruise lines, Norwegian, Ocean and Regent, 28 ships across these lines. They go to pretty much every port that is big enough to handle them, hundreds of countries. Any major country that's got ocean borders will have one of these ships coming through. They do cruises from 3 days to 180 days. So they sort of cover the whole lot. And needless to say, I mean, everyone knows cruise ships have a reputation for being, you know, quite good at disseminating disease, whether it's bacterial or, in this case, viral. So 2020s absolutely destroyed them. In fact, the losses that Norwegian made wiped out the entire last prior decade net income. Wiped out the whole lot. So I don't want to get bogged down in too much COVID discussion, but there's sort of three key points that I saw for Norwegian where COVID is going to impact their business on an ongoing basis, at least in the short term. And that's, you know, the time frame I'm looking at. So obviously we've got all these variants that are coming out now that are causing some concern. You know, India's obviously a total disaster. So there's issues around that. The second point is around vaccine durability. Many countries in the world are doing a very good job at vaccinating people. We don't know how long that's going to last. Pfizer's talking about the need for additional boosters next year and maybe the year after. And so that is yet to be seen. And the third point around COVID for these businesses is a vaccine passport. And there's no universal passport. And I suspect if you went to a random person in the US who said, I've had my two vaccinations for COVID, and you said, well, prove it, you know, the best they could probably do is pull out some piece of paper. And that's just not going to cut it, I don't think, on a global scale when people are still going to be have ongoing concerns about a pandemic. So that needs to be sorted out. Additionally, the ports, you know, it's all good and well having a ship. It's all good and well having it operate well and being safe, but you have to go into ports. And I struggle at the moment to see who are going to be the countries and the cities and the ports that are going to say, okay, well, I'm opening up to you and your 5,000 passengers and come on in, go crazy at the bars and restaurants and the shops for the next 6 or 7 hours and then head off, knowing that you've just been to 4 or 5, 6, 10 other countries potentially that may not have COVID under control. They may have, and everyone's just going to err on the side of caution. So Canada's said, sorry, no ships until 2022 at a minimum. The US has come out now and saying mid-July. So that's a positive for all the cruise lines. There are 74 protocols that the CDC is saying they need to have to be up and running. So that's going to impact things operationally. But to me, these things are all skewed to the downside. So Norwegian's come out and said, we're going to start restart some operations in Europe in August and the US in July, now that the CDC has said that's something you can do. But those dates are not coming forward. All they can do is slip. They can only slip out to September or October or November if there's any little hiccup. So I'm looking for skew and risk to that downside. And I think these, you know, this industry and this company has that. So their operations, if we look at those as they come out of this, you know, they've done all sorts of great things to be COVID compliant and spent capital on, you know, air recycling, all these types of things. But these are, one, they're expensive. Two, they're going to require reduced capacity. So they've suggested already that the early start is only going to be operating at 50% capacity. Well, these ships are simply not economic at that level. So they've been burning cash at a pretty crazy rate. And that's going to continue even when they're up and running, if they're running at 50%. Additionally, there are concerns around oil. So obviously this time last year, oil was a negative price. It's now picked up a lot. And these guys haven't hedged in the way that they have in the past, which makes sense because they've not been using a great deal of oil. But if they're going to start up in the way that they think they will in 2022, they're going to find themselves under-hedged in a pretty big way. So that's going to cause some concerns. The only way that they actually will wind up being sort of properly hedged is if they're performing at a much reduced capacity, which would be a negative in itself. So either way, I think there's concerns around oil price. They're either going to be unhedged and exposed to higher oil prices, or they're going to have reduced capacity. Multiple-wise and valuation-wise, as I said, $12 billion of debt. That's a big, big number. You can see it showing up in some of the multiples. So their price-to-sales multiples, it's up to sort of 8.7 times, mainly because the sales number is so low. That is up from sort of 2 to 3 times historically. But the enterprise value, which includes that debt, is up to 16 times from 2 to 3 times. So they're in a situation where they've got lots of debt. They've got plenty of cash on the balance sheet at the moment, but they're burning through sort of, you know, $190 a month, $190 million a month at the moment. So again, that whole thing is going to be skewed to the downside. They're going to burn through more cash than we would expect, to the point that they've had to go and secure covenant waivers from their debt providers all the way through to 2022 because they're in breach of those as we speak. And if things get worse, there's going to be ongoing breaches. One thing they have done well, though, is raise capital. So for the fourth quarter, they raised $1.6 billion and they burnt through $570 million of that. So it leaves them at the end of last quarter with about $3.3 billion. That number's obviously coming down a little bit, but still got plenty of cash to see them through, you know, a good year or so without having any sort of major concerns. But if they don't, if they're not up and running within the sort of the next year or so, then this stock's going to be under serious, serious pressure. So despite all of that, they're going to have negative free cash flow for the next sort of 3 years or so. As I said, $190 billion a month at the moment maybe gives a maximum of sort of 2 years runway as they pick up, but probably less than that. Looking a little further into the numbers, though, there are additional concerns as we move forward is that anyone who had previously booked and had their trips cancelled because of COVID could take cash or they could take future cancellation credits. We can go and rebook. And a lot of people, so demand is strong, have taken the future cancellation credits. However, we've still got 60% of those people to rebook. And there's not an infinite amount of space on these boats. If someone who is using, who has paid in the past and the cash has already come into the business is using a credit, then that is taking the spot of someone who's going to be paying cash and new money. So that's an additional negative for cash flow. And as much as they say these bookings are as important as the other ones, it's not particularly good for the cash and for the business. So I expect to see earnings downgrades for 2022. I wouldn't be surprised to see earnings downgrades for 2021. To give you an idea, we're looking at on the back of $8.45 a share loss last year. The average forecast consensus is for $5.98 loss this year and a small profit of 51 cents in 2022, with most of that obviously falling in the back half of the year. The skew as well and the range of those forecasts provides, again, a little bit of concern. The range for 2021 is a $7.32 loss down to a loss of only $4.80. I think those people at $4.80 are going to have to downgrade their numbers, and there's quite a lot of them. So we've got COVID, we've got operational delays, we've got ports remaining an issue, and just getting these ships up and running through to the end of the year is going to take a real, real effort. So we've got, in my mind, some serious concerns. The skew is very much to the downside. I'd expect to see earnings downgrades. And if there is any hiccup in terms of the reopening that we're going to see, then those downgrades will come through thick and fast. And as people push those earnings out further, suddenly you move into concerns about the levels of debt again and, potentially raising money, whether it's equity or debt, I don't know. But that's going to be an ongoing issue. Now, the results are out this Thursday. We're recording this on Wednesday, so probably will come out before this goes to air. So it'll be interesting to see what happens. Because of this short time frame here and the possibility that some of these things may take a little while to unfold, I'd sort of want to see through to the summer. So like Raj, I'm looking a little further out. So I'm looking at a calendar spread with plenty of time frame to buying September $30 puts for $4. I can sell May 21, so only 2 weeks away. But the price is actually pretty high. It takes into this earnings result. I mean, you can get $1.80 for those. So I would do a 2-for-1 ratio. If it loses on this result, if they disappoint in the way that that they might, we've still got a net short position. But if it does hum along and take a while to unfold and we get those delays and the downgrades coming through, then we're going to get some credits from these May puts. And we can potentially do the same thing for June and maybe even July as well if it keeps going along that way. It's a reopening reversal. I suspect reopening is going to go very well for things like domestic airlines in the US and retail. The US has done a cracking job at of rolling out the vaccine, but global travel, I think, is going to be on hold for quite some time. And I think Norwegian and all the cruise lines are probably going to wind up disappointing the market.
Okay, good stuff. Raj, let's go back to you. Do you have any longs to look at?
I do. It's actually funny Anthony was talking about this, because my long is actually in a sector that somewhat correlated to this, which is in shipping. But broadly, let me talk about longs. It seems like these days right now, the market is punishing anything without earnings. So when I was looking at my book and my trades, I wanted to go into something that had actually very high earnings. And, usually I look at higher PE names, but I wanted something with lower PE just as a hedge, just so in case this trade continues. I don't like to call it a hedge, but something like a diversified trade that doesn't fit with the rest of my longs. So the name that I came up with here was DAC Danaos, which is a $1.1 billion market cap, also a little bit lower than what I normally look at. But if you look at the earnings, the company is expected to make $12.84 this year, $13.20 in 2022, and $13.76 in 2023. Now, I want to look even further into the 2021 numbers, because if you look at the quarter by quarter, the first quarter was expected to be about 117% year-over-year growth. Now, again, remember that you know, all of last year or COVID year. So, you know, obviously it's a, you know, this is not a normal year, but the second quarter is expected to grow by 96% quarter over quarter. Third quarter is around 87%. And fourth quarter around 64%. Now those are declining a little bit, but it's still, you still see that the earnings are going to be very, very strong this year. And the PE is a sub 5 PE, which this sector trades at one of the lowest PEs in the market because the market just doesn't like the shipping companies. Now when I look into the sector, I like this company. I like the whole sector. I like this company a little bit more than everybody else. But again, I think this, if you look at names that we normally have in your portfolio, this is not something you normally would have. And there's a couple of reasons I really like it as a differentiator. So the company itself is the largest, it's one of the largest international owners of cargo container ships or cargo ships, as most people refer to them. They tend to focus on the largest companies. And if you measure it by TEU capacity, which is 20 equivalent units, which is basically the measure of the units of how much cargo units move. And so keep in mind that 90% of this non-bulk cargo is moved by these ships. Now it's interesting when Anthony was talking about the cruise lines. I agree with that in some ways. Like why would countries want visitors from other countries that may be, you know, bringing COVID, but they're clearly going to want the cargo to come in. And this is, and I think we all know that that's obviously going to be the case. So we don't want your people, but we want your goods. So if you look at the company itself, it's got a backlog of 1.2 billion backlog from out to 2028. And, you know, using this method, like the cargo, business is clearly going to be profitable going forward. Now, obviously, one of the risks is, as Anthony kind of pointed out, was oil prices. But, you know, should oil prices stay stable, even below 80 here, this company could really be profitable. And the other thing, too, that some of the market's missing is, while they might have inflation in terms of oil hedges, there's no wage inflation for the workers. Now, most of these workers have been either not working or underworked for the last year. So they'll be dying to go back and go to work. So while they can pass, because of the inflation in goods that they're selling, they can pass along the price increases to the companies that want them to ship their goods, but they won't actually have to pay their employees more. So that's a potential real tailwind to this business model that the market may be underpricing or maybe just not factoring or maybe not factoring to their models. So, you know, it, by the nature of this business, it's a very sticky business. You can't just build the ship and then get contracts with big companies. These contracts and these relationships have been there for a long time. And obviously it's not an easy business to learn. So the operational expertise and the professional reputation is all important. And even so, I think we'll even go more so when you're talking about countries and companies letting in newer businesses without the proper, you know, hygiene or process in place. It's less likely for new competitors to come into this business and disrupt this technology. And especially this company that focuses on the bigger TEUs, they should clearly be in a good spot. So, as you know, some of the trends that are going to continue, global restocking is obviously going to continue. The market supply is limited. If you look in this company, their new orders represent only 15% of their order books. And so, as you can see, most of their business is already in. It's just a backlog. And I don't see how that backlog stops anytime soon. If you bought anything, you know, everything takes, even just a manufacturer, the standard is 4 to 6 weeks for anything. So imagine how much that, when you're talking about moving stuff around the world, how much that's going to that's just going to stay for probably years and years because of what happened this year. Average container ships are the rates are in record highs since 2017. So even with that, that's another, and also it's got very strong supply side dynamics. So another thing too, as you think about this also, to me, I don't like to use the word hedge often, but this is somewhat of an inflation hedge because as prices go higher, there's no way this company does well. And so should we see a bit of a global slowdown, this company still has all these orders in the backlog. So they will continue to have good profits, at least in the next 3 to 6 months, even should there be some slowdown elsewhere. So on a relative basis, no matter what your view on is the market, I think that this company, this sector, should have a outperformance relative to everything else, or at worst, just a equal performance should the rest of the world just pick up in demand. So, you know, in summary, you know, with the inflation and when the vessel rates, that's a tailwind. I think this has a significant potential for EPS and NAV gains. And like I said, wage inflation, they don't have to pay their employees more because they just need work. And crude itself, that's the only potential headwind, but I think it's kind of leveling off here. So without any big increase in the price of crude, I think we're pretty good here. You know, what some people think that maybe the demand for hard goods will decrease later in the year when we go back to services, or customer experiences, but I don't really buy that. I think Q4 is holiday season, so people want something they can hold. So anyway, there's a lot to like about this company. In terms of structure, they report May 10th. And so the volatility in May options is very high. So I like to use that to my advantage here. The trade that I like here is with the stock trade in the below 65, I'm looking to buy two of the July 65 calls for $7 on a ratio and selling one of the May 70 calls for $2. I think those are very high. I don't think the stock will get above 70 in the short term. But even if it does, even if you lose a little bit on that May, say it goes to 75, you'll make a lot on the July 65s and vols will continue to go higher. And I think as you see stuff pick up around the world, the stock just continues to march higher into the summer. So this is a structure that I really like in the sector, and that's a name that I really do like here.
Cool. Awesome. Let's sort of finish up with you, Anthony. If you got anything else you wanted to mention, whether it's stocks or anything else.
So I do, and I've probably got a stock that is the exact opposite of the company Raj has just talked about. This company doesn't have solid earnings, and it is in an exciting business and not something that is sort of, you know, a staple like shipping. And the company is Virgin Galactic. And essentially with this company, what you're doing is you are funding Richard Branson's dream for him. So you can see this picture here of their, I'll call it a spaceship. And it's a very impressive vehicle, that's for sure. This company is a $5 billion market cap. It's trading at $20. It's down from its recent high of 52 and up from a low of 14 last year. And yesterday, or last yesterday, was up 4.4% on a rumor that Blue Origin, one of its competitors, is selling tickets in their sort of intergalactic, or not intergalactic, I shouldn't say, but galactic space vehicle for private passengers at $500,000 a pop. So Virgin has had a spike on that, given that their tickets are $250,000. I guess people are thinking we might be able to see a price increase and demand is good. So needless to say, this is another short idea. And it's got two sort of prongs and two reasons for it for me. One is, it is a wonderful idea, but a piece of crap as a company. And as a result of that, It's also going to be a little bit of an inflation hedge if we see one of these spikes that we saw in February, where very long duration stocks get belted. So I think it's going to be a big underperformer anyway, but if that inflation spike happens, it's going to be doubly so. So this company has been around for quite a long time, actually, and was targeting commercial flights to be launched in 2009. It's 2021 now, obviously, and they've only had a couple of test flights. And only twice have they achieved what they set out to do, and that is to break outside the Earth's atmosphere in this vehicle. So who wants to go to space? A huge amount of people do, actually. I mean, I wouldn't mind doing it. I know Anton wouldn't mind doing it. I suspect Chris and Raj probably want to go as well. There's been lots of surveys. Given the price ticket at $250,000 per seat, most of those surveys of high net worth people, and 39% of people are saying they're keen to go. So demand is clearly there for something like this. And they're looking at three different markets. They're looking at private astronauts, as they're calling them, microgravity research, and pro astronaut training operations. So huge demand, massive price. You know, how hard can it be? Pretty hard, actually, because if according to analysis that's done, they would need to build 11 or 12 spacecraft by 2030 to meet the targets that have been discussed. Each of these hold six people. So you're looking at about 3,400 passengers a year. So, you know, $250,000, that's happy days, right? Well, not really, because firstly, they've only got one ship currently and it's in test mode. And these projections are annual revenue. It only leads to $850 million in annual revenue. Its market cap's currently $5 billion. So you've got a stock that's trading on six times 2030's sort of fantasy sales numbers. So big concerns on that front and a very hard path to get anywhere near that. If we look at what they've done in 2020, you know, they put up their list of achievements and it's a very, very ho-hum list of achievements at best. They moved their operations to New Mexico, so they've given themselves a big tick for that. They've done two successful glide flights. They've cleared seven additional FAA verification reports, and they've got two more to go. They did a small step program where they tested the water on demand, got 1,000 participants. You know, great. They've strengthened their balance sheet with a capital raising, so that was something they did actually do very well. Raise money when the price was high. They conducted one test flight. You may have seen it, and it is outrageously impressive watching them go up to the edge of the atmosphere and beyond. But that's about it. And, you know, I would talk about the financials of this company, but they basically don't have any. I mean, they raise money and they spend it, and that is literally all they do. They burn through $1 million a day on average, not including weekends, so about $270 million last year, $220 million a year before. And as I said, one major success, which was raising $440 million from the market. So they've got enough cash to see them through for the next couple of years, burning through at the current rate. While they were raising this money from the public, though, Richard Branson sold $650 million of his own stock in the company. And the chairman sold every share that he owns. So not exactly a vote of confidence from the people who brought this to market via a SPAC, which is, you know, increasingly becoming an issue in itself. So where are they at now? They've got one ship. February test flight was postponed until May. Haven't seen much in the way of news about that yet, so it certainly hasn't happened. This is, you know, so they've done one of three major test flights, and there should be a lot more to come. So by way of comparison, if, you know, Boeing, new airline, the 787, they tested six planes for over thousands and thousands of hours before any passenger got anywhere near it. So for me, this is just the biggest pipe dream stock. Wonderful idea. once it's all up and running, I'm happy to get involved. But you are literally funding Richard Branson's dream on this. And the CEO recently made a statement as part of their last quarterly numbers where he essentially told you that their backs are against the wall and you know, you're funding a long duration dream. He said, for us to make the business start to scale at the places that we're aspiring towards, so this is the 2030 numbers, we need two things. We need many more ships than we have right now, and we need ships that bring forward to be built in a way that can be maintained so we can have a quicker turnaround between flights than we do currently. So essentially, they're saying they've got no chance in hell of delivering on these numbers, which are pretty much fairy tale numbers anyway. So there's no revenue, there's no numbers, they raise money, they burn cash, that's it. The results were due to be out tonight. The SEC is cracking down on SPACs and the way that they were listed, and particularly issues regarding their warrants. So the result has been delayed until the 10th of May. But I can't imagine they're going to say anything much more than, you know, we've spent a truckload more money again and we've got enough money to last us for, you know, a year or two. And we've got, you know, some great ideas and it's, you know, we'll do a test flight again sometime soon. So the trade is pretty simple for mine. The stock's around $20. You can buy June $20 puts at the moment for $285. I sort of looked at a few other structures and decided for me, I just want to keep this simple. We've got a break even at $17.15. If we see an inflation spike, then it's going to get absolutely belted. I don't see why I couldn't trade down to $10. Its all time low is just over $7. If we get towards 10, I don't see why you wouldn't be looking towards that all-time low. I don't know why this company is even listed. I mean, it is literally, you know, makes next to no revenue whatsoever. It is R&D the whole way. Maybe in a year or two, they can start doing some very basic commercial payloads, but it's not going to be scalable. It's not going to be commercial, I don't think, anytime in the next decade. Could be wrong, but that's okay. I only need to be right for the next month or two, and I suspect I will be. So that's how I do it. The June 20 puts, just buying them outright, Chris.
Awesome. Great stuff, guys. Well, it's fantastic to hear from you both today. I think we'll leave it there. It's always interesting to hear you guys talk about, you know, your process, your idea generation process with shorts, because certainly in quite recent episodes of What's On Your Mind, we have had quite a few longs, so it's great to hear about some shorts as well. I'm sure there's plenty for our viewers to take away there. And speaking of you guys, the viewers as well, as always, make sure you check out our events page on our website, itpm.com, for upcoming events that we're holding for you. There's lots of things you can learn from those events. So a couple that we've got coming up, there's two alumni only webinars coming up in the next month or so. One is on May 15th, how to cut losses efficiently. That's with Ben Bergreen and Anton Creel. We've also got another one hosted by Raj here and Anton as well. That's May 29th, again, alumni only. And that's called how to read an options chain. So those will both be really interesting for our alumni. And then open to everyone, we have an ITPM half-year conference coming up in June. I think that's on the 26th. All of our mentors that you see on What's On Your Mind and Anton will be talking about various trading topics in that one. That's definitely a good one for you all to attend. So put that in the diary if you think you're available and want to attend. You can find more information on our website about that and sign up, of course. So lots to get your teeth stuck into for you guys. But as far as What's On Your Mind goes, we're done for today. I hope you guys enjoyed it, and we'll be back again in a couple of weeks' time with another episode.